our belief in divine healing. We believe that Exodus tells us in Exodus 15, 26, I, the Lord, am your healer. And we talked about how God is a healer. Last week we talked about, I believe Jesus is coming back. And we believe in a second coming of the Lord, the rapture of the church, and all that that will usher in. And today we're going to finish by talking about, I believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. As I was preparing this week, I came across some interesting beliefs of some other religious groups. I found a belief that Mormons believe that sacred underwear protects believers from spiritual contamination, and according to some adherents, fire and speeding bullets. So apparently there's some Mormon Superman underwear that you can get. They also believe Jesus is coming back right here in Jackson County, many believe, so, you know, who knows. Well, God knows, but they also believe in the end times. Like I said, Jesus, God's gathered people, his holy ones, will be gathered to Jackson County, Missouri, for the return of Christ. According to Islam, there was a prophet that once traveled between two cities on a miniature flying horse that had the face of a woman and the tail of a peacock. It's pretty cool. I would like one of those horses. You know, it'd be pretty awesome. According to Scientology, every human being contains many alien spirits that were trapped in volcanoes by hydrogen bombs. So you can see there are a lot of interesting beliefs out there, to say the least. And that's just the tip of the iceberg of strange beliefs that you can find. But it reminds us again to understand what we believe and why we believe it. Some people say that you should have blind faith. I don't think God intends any of us to be blind in our faith. He has given us plenty of reasons to know that his word is true and that it applies to our lives. I heard some guys the other day, I had to make a delivery out to Kansas State University in Manhattan. And so I left middle of the morning and drove out there. And on my way back, I stopped at a gas station, and it was staffed, of course, by a bunch of college guys. And they were talking about this movie, Noah. And one of them made the comment, you know, they showed these bad guys in the movie that were trying to kill Noah, and one of the other guys goes, well, isn't God really the bad guy in that movie? And I'm like, let me just give you guys a little pointer. If you don't know, the man that made the movie Noah is a professing atheist and is very proud of the fact that his movie with Russell Crowe doesn't have very much in common with the actual biblical account of a worldwide flood. Okay, but you don't have to accept that on blind faith, because you can go to the geological record and realize some simple things. That you can go into Colorado in the mountains, and in the sedimentary rock, which if anybody knows how sedimentary rock is formed, it's formed by the recession of waters. And in that sedimentary rock in the Rocky Mountains, you will find fossils of sea life, shells, little fish. Well, how did those sea animals get all the way up in the Rocky Mountains? Well, the Bible tells us that there was at one time a world that was so wicked that God said, I cannot contend with men any longer. And among all the wicked men, you might have seen I shared a post about how Noah was a sinner from another pastor named Mark Batterson. You can read that. You can find it on my Facebook page. But Noah happened to be a sinner that was more favored and chosen by God among a bunch of really bad sinners. So not that Noah was this perfect angelic man, but Noah had some problems. You can see right after the ark fell, what was the first thing he did? Planted a vineyard and got drunk. All right, Noah had some issues. Let's just be honest about that. Every one of us has issues too, but that tells me God is good enough to take a man with issues and do something great with him, right? So anyway, the word tells us, God's word says that the entire world was covered with water. The highest peaks were covered with water, which that would be Mount Everest. Even Mount Everest, it tells us how deep the water was above Mount Everest. And if that water covered Mount Everest to a certain depth, then it covered the entire globe. And it's just not that Noah got a bunch of animals and hid them together in the ark and then they floated for a couple days. No, it was like a year as the water receded for a long time, which means that things got trapped. And fossils were formed in sedimentary rock. You can go to the Grand Canyon and see layers upon layers upon layers of sedimentary rock. And that rock only forms by the recession of waters. So we don't have to take the word as blind faith that God's word is true. God gives us reasoning, a reasoning mind, which we can use our reasoning minds to say, Lord, you're telling me something and it applies to my life. Now help me to live out this belief. All right? So I'm saying that if you hear me say something from the pulpit and you don't agree with it, go to the Word and we'll have a dialogue. And we'll find truth together. But it comes from His Word. Amen? Don't take these crazy beliefs that special underwear is going to protect you or that you've got alien spirits that are trapped inside of you from a hydrogen bomb in a volcano. The only time I saw that happen was in Despicable Me number 2. If you saw Despicable Me number 2, the bad villain supposedly died strapped to a shark and a bomb in a volcano. But then he really faked his own death. So that's about as much credence as I give to aliens trapped me from Scientologists. Today we're going to talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit from the fundamental truths of the Assemblies of God. Again, you can read these for yourselves. You're going to jot this down, ag.org. Click on the beliefs tab and you can read all sorts of papers, literature, scriptural backstory for any of the things we talked about, any of the other beliefs we have, position papers as a church that we have on certain cultural issues. You can find those there. But ag.org would be the site that you could look up if you want to on your own. Talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, it says, we believe that all believers are entitled to and should ardently expect and earnestly seek the promise of the Father, the baptism in the Holy Spirit and fire, according to the command of our Lord Jesus Christ. This was the normal experience of all in the early Christian church. When, with it comes the endowment of power for life and service, the bestowment of gifts and their uses in the work of the ministry. And this tells us very clearly that the baptism in the Holy Spirit is a gift, and it comes from the Father. That's what we believe. That's what the Word says. Jesus, in fact, himself told us in Acts chapter 1, verse 4, he said, while he was with them, he declared, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait there for what my Father promised, which you heard about from me. So like I said a number of weeks ago, the book of Acts is really could be entitled the Acts of the Holy Spirit, because we see the activity of the Holy Spirit all through the Word. But at the beginning, the great writer Luke is trying to give a great account of what happened through Christ in his book, Luke. He's writing to a man named Theophilus. He says, in my former account to you, Theophilus, oh great Theophilus, I said, you know, what happened to Jesus. Now, we're going to pick up at the end of Jesus' life and ministry on earth and see what happens in his church. And while Luke finds it very important to remind us that Jesus is telling his disciples and his followers after he has been crucified and resurrected, prior to him ascending to the right hand of the Father, he gives these words of instructions to the disciples. And he says, wait in Jerusalem for what my Father promised. God the Father. So here again, we see example of Trinity in the Bible. The Father is speaking to Jesus. The Holy Spirit is about to be poured out. That's why we believe in Trinity. But Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he goes on from 1-4, and he tells them what they're going to be expecting. What is it that they're waiting for? What is this gift that the Father has promised? And verse 8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the farthest parts of the earth. So we see in verse 4 that Jesus commanded his disciples to wait for the gift of the Father and the Holy Spirit. But why were they supposed to wait? What was the purpose in them waiting for this gift from God? And the answer is power. Jesus said, wait for the gift because you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. So does that command apply to us today? Some people interpret the Bible and they say that, well, Jesus was only talking to the disciples. And he was only talking to the followers that were there. We know there was 120 in this upper room experience. So Jesus was only talking to them. So this promise of the Holy Spirit only applies to them. And we don't have any need for it today. And there are a lot of churches that go around and they would condemn us for believing something else. But we believe this is a normal practice in the early church. And that this command to wait to receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you was not just for the first century Christians and those that saw Jesus, but it's for us today. Why? Look what he says. The power is so that you can be what? Witnesses. Does Jesus still need a strong witness in Kansas City today? Yes. So if we are still called to be the same witnesses as the Christians in the first century, then doesn't it reason that this promise is for us? In fact, in talking about this promise, we go back to the Old Testament to a prophet named Joel. And he said, this promise is for you and for your children and for those that are far off. Your young men will what? Prophesy. Your old men will see visions and prophesy, right? All this is from the Old Testament, hundreds of years until Jesus makes this promise, this command, wait for the Holy Spirit, the gift from the Father. And so, yes, it does apply to us. We need the power of the Holy Spirit active in our lives to be effective witnesses in this day and age. Amen? When we talk about the baptism in the Holy Spirit, I believe that this is a life that is surrendered to Christ. You know, I have a picture here of a water baptism, Fred. Okay, now, here's somebody being baptized in water. And if you think about baptism and the way we believe baptism happened, they went to the Jordan River because there was enough water there to baptize. In other words, they were submerged. And in water baptism, you go under the water, signifying that your old life is dead under the water, and you are raised to new life in Christ as you come out of the water. It's a public profession of an inward confession. That's water baptism. So I find it interesting that you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit should give us an image. Well, if I'm baptized in water, the evidence is that I come up wet. If I'm baptized in the Holy Spirit, what is the evidence in my life? There has to be a proof. We're going to get to a little bit more of that, but a big part of this is power. When we are completely surrendered to the activity of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we are covered, we're surrendered, we're filled with the power that he has. A life that is completely surrendered to the Holy Spirit should bear the fruit of the Spirit. Amen? Galatians chapter 5, Paul writes to the church in Galatia and he says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. I think the Neils just went there for the kids' names. I'm pretty sure there's running out of names here. Let's just go. Galatians 5's got a few. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. And he goes on to say, those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh. We're talking about that in a couple weeks here. Dead come to life, right? With its passions and desires. And then in verse 25, he gives us a very important if-then statement. A lot of logic and reasoning happens when you understand an if-then statement. Anybody study if-then statements maybe in math in high school? Yeah. The statement is, if this happens, then this is true. If 1 plus 1 equals 2, then 1 plus 2 cannot equal 2, right? If then. We have something that's happening. If I fell off the roof working with Eddie yesterday, then I will be dead on the pavement. If then statement. It applies. Verse 25 says, if we live by the Spirit, you can insert a silent then, let us also behave in accordance with the Spirit. If then. If you say that you are going to be filled with the Spirit, then your life in accordance with the Spirit should bear the fruit of the Spirit. I think a lot of times in the Assemblies of God in Pentecostal churches, we focus on one thing. We talk about the Holy Spirit. We talk about speaking in tongues. And I think that applies and is important today. Don't get me wrong. Don't edit out this portion of this thing and send it into headquarters and get my credentials pulled. Because I believe that the initial physical evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is speaking with other tongues. Just as I believe that the evidence of being baptized in water is that you will be wet. But I think there's got to be a whole lot more than that. And church, I think that for too many years, we focus on speaking tongues, speaking tongues, speaking tongues, speaking tongues, and we've lost sight of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's the fruit of the Spirit in my life. And I've met a lot of people that claim to speak in tongues, and I've heard them speak in tongues, and they are mean as snakes. You know what I'm saying? My wife got mad at me yesterday because we were in the backyard hanging out and enjoying the day, and my son Keegan came to me, "Dad, there's a snake." And so all of us went and ran to the fence because there was a garter snake about yay long. And we saw one at Mark and Jen's house a week before, and Mark cut its head off with a shovel, and it still was moving around. That's how evil snakes can. Its body was severed, and it was trying to bite us still. I tried to catch it, but it was just a few feet ahead of me. And then my neighbors a little bit later are raking up leaves, and this guy jumps and says some non-appropriate words for church. And I was like, "What is it?" And he goes, "A snake. I hate those things." And sure enough, there's another garter snake zipping along his fence line. Some people are just mean as snakes, but they want to claim that they are full of the Holy Spirit and speak in other tongues. But how can those two, if Paul says, if we live by the Spirit, let us also behave in accordance with the Spirit. Amen. Well, how do I know I'm living in accordance with the Spirit, Paul? Oh, I told you that in verses 22 and 23. And then I reminded you of it in verse 24 that says, if we belong to Christ, we've crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. So this is a process, people. Don't get me wrong. I've not arrived. I just told you a couple weeks ago I wanted to flip somebody off on the highway, right? That's not very Christ-like. That's not very Spirit-led. I said I didn't, you know, and I'm working on that. And I've got some anger problems sometimes when I drive, but I think that's why my wife doesn't let me drive very much when she's in the car. It's a process. As you submit to the Spirit, you will grow in these things. It's not like you go out and plant a seed in the ground and the next day expect the fruit to be there. It's a process. I told you a couple weeks ago, my sister owned some land with a small orchard on it. And the first year, my dad bought this property first, and he renovated the house, rehabbed it, and then he sold it to my sister. But when we first went out there, we saw the trees. There was nothing on them. They had been neglected. You know what had to happen? He went and he did some research. He got some books about fruit trees, and he learned that if you want fruit to produce, you've got to trim away what is dead. There are branches that will grow, and they will no longer be productive. And so what you got to do is you've got to cut them off because they are sapping the nutrients from that tree, prohibiting the growth of fruit. But once you go in and you cut off what is dead and you cut back what is not being productive and you supply the water and the nutrients, then you know what? Crazy thing happens. Fruit starts to grow. And the more you tend to the life of the tree, the more juicy that fruit will be. I think that's a picture of what happens in our lives. Paul says it's the fruit of the Spirit. We are the tree. The Holy Spirit wants to flow power and nutrients and life into this frame. And if I will allow him to trim off what is dead and what is sapping energy from me, and the things that so easily would hinder me and hold me back, then the fruit of the Spirit will begin to blossom in my life, if I'll be obedient to that process. That's what he wants us to be, obedient to the process. The word says that we should seek the baptism in the Holy Spirit for a number of reasons. Jesus said, "For you will receive power." The Holy Spirit gives us power just as Jesus promised in Acts 1:8. But it doesn't stop there. You might want to write this down. There's a whole lot of stuff that the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life if you will allow him to do it. The Holy Spirit wants to bring fullness to your life. This is described in the baptism of the Holy Spirit because he fills us and he overflows out of us. And we see this in John chapter 7. Verses 37 to 39, and the first part of Acts chapter 4, verse 8. The Holy Spirit brings fullness. He will overflow out of you if you will allow him. The Holy Spirit, when he fills your life, brings reverence. He causes us to have a more deepened reverence for God. We see this happen in Acts chapter 2, verse 43. We also see this reference in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 28. The Holy Spirit will bring dedication. The Holy Spirit's baptism gives us an intensified dedication to God and a deeper dedication to His work. That's Acts chapter 2, verse 42. Love. The Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit gives us a more active love for Christ, for His word, and for the lost. We begin to love Jesus. You'll love the word. You'll love the people that don't know Him in a greater way. Mark 16, verse 20 says this. So are we really seeking the Holy Spirit just so we can talk in tongues? Or are we seeking the Holy Spirit so He can fill us, so He can give us reverence, so He can give us dedication, so He can give us power, so He can give us love? The baptism in the Holy Spirit, who said the evidence of being baptized in water is that you're wet. The baptism in the Holy Spirit, the evidence of that, we see throughout the book of Acts, is that you will speak in other tongues. We believe that the baptism of believers in the Holy Spirit is witnessed by the initial physical sign of speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives them utterance. So again, we look back at Acts chapter 2. What does the word say? And Luke tells us in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, as these believers were being obedient to Christ and waiting together in Jerusalem, the gift that the Father gave them was the Holy Spirit. And we see in verse 4, he says, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And so a lot of times we kind of quote this verse and don't really think about what's happening as Luke says it's happening. We see that they speak in other tongues, but why? What's the importance of tongues? Jerusalem at this time was filled with people that were coming for the celebration of the Feast of Pentecost. They came from all parts of the known world and were making a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. And they were coming together. They were Jewish people, believers in God, and they were coming together to worship Him in this feast. Now, we think now of Pentecost as just baptism, Holy Spirit, fire, speaking in tongues, power. But Pentecost has been a lot longer than that. It's an Old Testament feast. And so we see that as these believers came together, the Spirit of God fell and filled these 120 in the upper room, and they began to speak in other tongues. But you know what the tongues were? Tongues that could be understood at this time. Why? Because they will be witnesses of whom? Jesus. So all these Jewish believers had come together, and many of them spoke different languages. And the Holy Spirit fills these people with other tongues, and they begin to praise God in languages that could be understood by these pilgrims outside that were filling Jerusalem. And then what happens? Peter comes down, and a bunch of people said, oh, those people are drunk up in that room right now. And Peter comes down and says, no, it's just morning. Let me tell you what really happens. And he gives witness to Christ at this time. Now, that's not always the case. When you speak in other tongues, you don't always speak a different language. But we see that this speaking in other languages happens. If you want to do a study to see what it says, do a study of Acts chapter 8, chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 19. And you'll see that in these times, the baptism of the Holy Spirit was something that could be evidenced. It could be seen and heard. Okay? Those are important things because you see throughout the rest of Acts, in Acts 8, 9, 10, and 19, when people are filled with the Holy Spirit, and Luke tells us about it, it was evidenced by something that could be seen and heard. And that's why we believe today that this baptism of the Holy Spirit is something that still can be seen and heard. So if you've not experienced that yet, don't get discouraged. It's a gift that God wants to give. And you know what? Here's the crazy thing about gifts. They happen at the right time. It would be ridiculous for me to go out and buy a used car for my son, Gavin. Why? Because Gavin is only going to be 10 this summer. He can't use that gift right now, right? It would sit and it wouldn't be the right time for that gift to come. But gifts come at the right time. God wants to give them. Amen? Now, what do? We continue to wait for the gift of the Father. And at the right time, I believe he will give the gifts that we should have. Amen? Now, on, like I said, on the day of Pentecost, they spoke in languages that could be understood. A number of years ago, Mel and I took a group of students to Mexico, in the Baja of Mexico, in a place called San Quintin. And there were a number of farming villages there. And one night, we were in church, and we were preaching about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And one of the girls that was from the local area, the local church, she had been a part of our, she'd come and kind of helped us. Our translator became very good friends with this young girl named Laura. And I remember that night she was in the altar and she was seeking this gift of God. And she didn't speak English, okay? She only spoke Spanish. And so us gringos from Kansas were trying to communicate in the little bit of broken Spanish that we knew, and she would try, but she could not speak English. And that night in the service, there were some boys that were from Fallbrook, California, which is where Mel and I used to be youth pastors when we first were married. And these boys had gotten in trouble with some gangs in their hometown of Fallbrook, and their moms sent them to Mexico and took their passports, took their IDs. So they couldn't come home until they straightened up. She sent them to grandma's house in Mexico. And we're not talking like across the border in Tijuana. We were about 4 hours from U.S. territory, deep in the heart of the Baja of Mexico. And these boys got drugged to church that night. And we were praying, and we knew these guys were wannabe little gangbangers, little cholos, and they wanted to prove that they were stuff. And so they're there, and we were trying to talk to them and say, hey, we used to be youth pastors there, and talking to them about life. And I remember we were praying, and Laura was over on the side of the altar, and she was just seeking God. And the Holy Spirit just was filling this place. And little Laura, in perfect English, began to say, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Not a hint of an accent. In perfect English. Something that she had never done before, and we tried afterwards. Laura, say, and it was in very thick accent. And I remember Mel talking to these two boys. He said, see what happened? And they're both jaw dropped. Like, we know Laura, and we know she can't speak English. And she's just worshiping. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. And the Holy Spirit came, and in that moment, used Laura as a witness to these two boys to show the power of God. And you know what? That's not an isolated incident, because I've read stories of in the Azusa Street Revival where the Pentecostal, modern Pentecostal movement was born and thrived, of people coming and being doubters from all parts of the world, and people in these meetings speaking tongues that were known of small tribes in remote parts of the world that these people had come from. And they said, how can this be but by the power of God? And the Holy Spirit moves in this way. But you know what? The Holy Spirit also fills you because you can communicate with your spirit to God's spirit through the Holy Spirit. And you speak another language that is a heavenly language. And it's a prayer language. And it's connecting you to the heart of the Father. And sometimes we see the Holy Spirit fills and people speak in a tongue. And there's an interpretation. And that comes by the power of God. And what's the purpose of that? It often is for the edification, the building up of the body of Christ. Amen. So you see, the Holy Spirit is kind of like a diamond, because he's got a whole lot of facets. And when you see him from different sides, you're going to see him doing something different in your life. So you can't say, God, fill me up and let me speak in another tongue. And I could everyone say this, shoulda? Everybody say it? Shoulda? Bada? Honda. Should have bought a Honda. Should have bought a Honda. Oh, wait, that's it. That's it. He's giving us a gift. Yes. Now, that's some preacher being stupid. The Holy Spirit wants to fill you, but you are you. You understand that? You are unique. You are different. And so the way the Holy Spirit filled me, maybe it won't be the same way the Holy Spirit fills you. And the way the Holy Spirit wants to speak through me, maybe it's not the same way the Holy Spirit's going to speak through you. And the gifts that the Holy Spirit is going to give to me are probably not going to be the same gifts the Holy Spirit is going to give to you, because you're you and I'm me. You know what the thing that brings us together is? The Holy Spirit wants to do something in us. He wants to do something through us. And if we allow him to, he wants to make us powerful witnesses. See, that night in Mexico all those years ago, Laura didn't show up to that church that night saying, I'm going to speak in English to show a couple little cholos from Fallbrook the power of God. She just showed up and said, here I am. Lord, fill me. Lord, take me. Lord, use me. And as the Holy Spirit filled her, she overflowed. And what overflowed out of her heart? Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. In a language she did not know. And God used it. The question is, will you do the same? Will you be the same? Here's the thing that has to define who you are. Paul gives some more instruction in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Verse 1, he says this, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but I do not have love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Love has to motivate the gifts of the Spirit in our lives. Love has to be the motivation. It says, I love you. Because of that, I want the Holy Spirit to use me. I love this world, and I want the Holy Spirit to use me. That's why I have my friends like Dave Dodd. He surrenders in love, and he's just going about his day. He's just traveling, and the Holy Spirit gives him a word of knowledge to the person that he's talking to at the Starbucks counter or at the sandwich shop or on the train or in the airport or at the hotel. And he shares these stories with me. He says, God rocked this person. Why? Because love is motivating him to be used by the Spirit and the gifts that the Holy Spirit has put in his life. It's all about surrender. Do you want God to use you in this way? You want to be filled, submerged, and surrendered to the Holy Spirit. The book of Acts describes a whole lot of people that were baptized in the Holy Spirit. Many of these people were baptized simply because some believers came and laid their hands on them and prayed for them, and they were filled with the Spirit. The believers in the upper room, what'd they do? They waited together, and they were in one accord. They were in unity, and the Holy Spirit came and filled them. The gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is simply given. I can't get up here and tell you the words to say. You know what? Sometimes you could just be seeking the Lord, and you'll kind of hear maybe some syllables, and that's the Holy Spirit wanting to speak through you. And just like you don't expect a baby to come out and start quoting Dostoevsky at 1 year old, what do babies say? Mama, dada. And then it turns into mommy and daddy. And then it might turn into mother and father. And then it turns into, hey, I need some money. Right? It's a progression. It's a growth. The Holy Spirit wants to fill you, but not just for a moment. He wants to start a process in your life that will bear fruit. Amen? Amen. What is there needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit? I believe it's surrender. It's surrender. It's first saying, I'm surrendered to Christ. And then saying, I'm surrendered, God, to whatever gifts you want to give me. That's as simple as it is. Many believers in Cornelius' house, we see that they were not even baptized yet, before they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. So you don't even have to get dunked in the water before the Holy Spirit dunked you, right? It's all about surrender. Let's stand this morning. Go ahead and play that track for me if you would, Fred. Father, today we come before you. Thank you for your word. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you are active in this world. You're active in our lives. Holy Spirit, I thank you that you want to use us in greater ways.